Hey, cinephile, this one's for you. Your love of film allows us to do what we do. If you want to support us, the best way to do so is to hit that subscribe button. From Spotify to Apple to our video versions on YouTube, subscribing matters. Feel really compelled? Well, we want to hear from you. Have a burning question? An indie filmmaker we need to interview or a film we need to know about? Think you can make us laugh on the air? Drop us a comment or a review.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Fandor Video Podcast. I'm Hooman. This is my amazing co-host, Chris Kelly.
Chris Kelly. Thanks, Hoo.
Oh, thank you. And
Brent. It's a good time to be alive, isn't it?
It really is. All right. Well, we have two very special guests. They run a website. Welcome, Joe Ziemba and Annie Choi. Woo! Hi, guys.
It's Joe Ziemba.
Ziemba.
You want to fix that and post? You want to do it now?
I'm actually going to log. I'm going to log off now. That's ridiculous. So thanks a lot.
I know I'm not the only one that's ever messed up your name, right? Come on.
No. Okay. No. It's not. Yeah.
Joe Ziemba. Welcome.
Hi. Thank you.
All right. Whoever wants to answer this first. What is Bleeding Skull?
Yeah, that's all you, dude.
Okay, I'll take this one. Bleeding Skull, it's, I guess basically it's an outlet to share our passion for obscure genre films and also honor the filmmakers behind them. And we do this through site reviews and home video releases and also our books.
Cool. And so how did Bleeding Skull come to be? And then Annie, how did you end up joining Joe?
Bleeding Skull started in a very, I didn't have any aspirations or anything. It just started as a hobby. It's kind of like an outlet to really just share my excitement about these movies that I was collecting and writing about. I'd never written anything in my life before Bleeding Skull started. So it just kind of started organically. And it was just something I launched as a hobby in 2004. And it grew from there. I think it was just because I did it so much. It was more of an escape for me, something that was really like a nice hobby to escape from the outside world. So it just kept building up and going and going, and we really never stopped. So,
What was your job at the time that Bleeding Skull started? What were you doing 9 to 5?
I was touring in a band 9 to 5.
Oh, wow. Have we heard of this band? Is it somebody famous?
Like, no, it was called The Like Young. That was
It was big. Come on, Joe. Don't sell yourself short.
Absolutely not.
If you bought like an iPod during that time, it came with one of their songs on it already.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. That's really cool.
Like, I didn't do that shit. Come on. Be proud of yourself, Joe. Be proud of yourself.
Yeah. Joe, are you performing anywhere? Is there anywhere we can see you these days? You got another band?
No. Well, Annie and I have a band called Taken by Savages, but we don't really play live. We just release music now. I think we're. I mean, I feel too old to play live anymore.
So we just opened a great new venue here in Menlo Park called Guild Theater that a bunch of folks put together. So we got a live music in Menlo Park all the time. Small venue, 500, it seats like 250, 500 for GA. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. So
come on out.
We're booking you right now.
Exactly. You guys want a tour. The Bleeding Skull tour.
Annie, do you sing in the band?
Yeah. I sing, play bass. Keys.
Oh, so what's the website for the band? Is there a website for the band? How can we hear the music?
It's takenbysavages.bandcamp.com.
Okay. All right. So Annie, since you're on, how did you become part of Bleeding Skull?
I met Joe forever ago in LA. That's where I'm from. He's friends. We have some mutual friends. And then we met and we started talking about movies. And he was like, well, I like to watch crazy movies. And I was like, you mean like Burial Ground? And he's like, oh shit. So I've been watching these movies in parallel and in tandem as he was doing that. I just never wrote about them, but all the low budget genre, deeper dives, less deep dive Italians, cannibals, you name it. I've been into it.
How many movies do you guys each watch a week?
Yeah, yours is way more impressive.
I mean, I would say like 4 to 8 a week, probably around there. It depends on the week. Sometimes I get hooked on TV shows and I won't watch movies for a week. But I'm watching so much constantly, not only for Bleeding Skull, just for fun, and then for AGFA too, and screeners and things like that for programming. So it's like, it's constant. I love it. It's the best. I just love watching movies. But yeah.
Wow. Is there ever a time where a movie is just so bad that you're like, I can't do it. There's no way I'm getting through this one.
Oh, yeah. That's like... 100%. Some of them are new.
Okay, good.
not everything you watch is old.
Yeah, I just didn't know if you guys were in the mindset where you're always giving things the benefit of the doubt and you give it, you know, you're always trying to find something good, redeeming. But are you honest where you're like, this is just terrible. I can't do it.
I think that I have a higher tolerance than maybe Joe. It's changed over the years. I think where Joe would like really suffer through, be like, it's gonna pull it out in the last 20 minutes. You know, everyone's all gone those movies where you're like,
yeah,
you know, but the last 15 minutes were really good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right.
And we've all been burned by that. Yeah.
So
yeah. But so in the years, I think I feel like I've gotten more patience and Joe's gotten less patience. But, you know, we go through phases.
Right. So you guys, you know, obviously there's a lot of death and horror and gore. And you're watching so much content. Do you ever find these images like affecting your dreams at night?
Well, I don't remember my dreams.
Oh, you don't?
Maybe it's because I'm like so high before I go to bed, but most part, I actually don't remember any of my dreams. So.
Well, there we go.
Yeah, so it's not a problem. I could watch whatever the fuck I want before I go to bed.
Not worried about Nightmare on Elm Street. You're not worried about Freddy Krueger options or
anything. No, no.
Let's talk about that for a sec. Is it edibles? Are you smoking? Like, what's your
edibles, but I'm not opposed to smoking. I like it. You know what? I like it in all forms. Nice. Just like people.
Oh, that's beautiful. Huh? Annie loves everyone. All right, Joe, come on. I know this is affecting your dreams, right? You must be having some nightmares.
No, actually they don't at all. Like I my dreams are more like anxiety based in real life. It'll be like trying to find my car at the airport and I can't find it. So it rarely involves, you know, guys in metal masks, chainsawing people in half, never. So yeah, I think it's because I've always looked at the movies ever since I was a kid as more, the gore is like artistic to me. And I always like, I'm impressed by it rather than scared by it. I think it's cool. Like how did people actually create that and make it real? Because it's not real. So it's like some permutation of reality. So it looks like an art project to me. So I think that's why I've always looked at it that way. It never really scared me even as a kid.
Fascinating.
What are the Bleeding Skull books and what do they cover?
Jeff.
Okay. we have two books to date. The first one is called Bleeding Skull, a 1980s TRASH-HORROR ODYSSEY. It was published by Headpress in 2013. And the second one is called Bleeding Skull, a 1990s TRASH-HORROR ODYSSEY, published by Fantagraphics in 2021. And I think they're pretty self-explanatory, but they're really just an exploration of the films that we felt were worth writing about in those two decades. And they're very different books in terms of the types of films that they cover. I think the 80s book definitely has more theatrical films and more movies that people have heard of before, whereas the 90s one is really deep and kind of really into the underground and DIY stuff, because that was like the nature of, you know, what was going on in the 90s. But yeah, I think that's kind of like pretty much how they worked out.
So you're working on the 2000s and 2010s or
We have, I think, three ideas for the next book that are in various stages. So I think we're taking a break now from any big projects at Bleeding Skull other than just writing reviews, because we needed it after the 90s book. It was a huge process that lasted like almost 6 years. So the next one is kind of floating around, but we have a couple of spreadsheets going. I'm not sure which one we'll do yet, but there'll be another one.
Very cool.
All right. So what concerns you? What bothers you about this statement? These films are so bad, they're good.
Oh my God.
Take it, Annie.
Come on.
To me, that statement is like picking on the fat kid at school. Mm. Like, stop. Just why are you doing this? To make yourself feel better? Like, these are movies that didn't have the same resources. They didn't have much of anything. They just had someone with a lot of fucking ambition.
Yeah.
Which should be celebrated. So why are you why are you punching down, I guess.
Oh, the punching down.
Yeah. To me, that's a punching down statement. There's if it's good, it's good. There's no, I mean, I don't even under, like, there's no, it's not bad.
Right.
It's like guilty pleasures. It's just pleasure. There's no guilt.
Yeah.
You love it? Then what the fuck is the problem? Enjoy your life. Do your thing. Life's short. Fucking watch whatever you want.
Just don't make fun of it.
Oh.
Exactly.
Yeah. I mean, I've always seen it as like a, on top of what Annie said, it's like comes from a kind of a place of privilege. Like, who gives you the right to interpret this in a way that you can just make fun of it and not accept it for what it is.
Right. Mm. But you like still watch the whole thing in order to come to that assessment. Right. Yeah. So it's like there are bad movies that you didn't finish and that's fine.
And then Andy, you're the greatest. I'm ever in New York. I mean, let's grab a cup of coffee.
All right. So I want to hear the connection between the America Genre Film Archive and Bleeding Skull.
Yeah, I think the connection is pretty much me because I'm my day job is a creative director of AGFA. So when the time came to when the home video arm of AGFA started up in 2017, we were interested in releasing movies that were shot on video or shot on tape. So we had a designation already for different releases, like AGFA releases were just AGFA. Then we had AGFA and Something Weird, which were movies from the Something Weird collection. So when it came time to do the video stuff, it was kind of made sense that it would be AGFA and Bleeding Skull. So that's how that happened.
What are three or four of the gnarliest, grossest movies you've ever seen?
You know what? Joe and I discussed this before.
Here we go. Everyone, right. Get your pen and paper out.
All right. There's only one movie. Well, No. There's multiple movies, but there's really only one gnarly one that is really just the worst. And that's Manhattan by Woody Allen.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, exactly. Everything else is great. That one's really fucked up and like not okay. And like, you know what? I can see like a cannibal movie and it's getting what it is. You see the inside of a turtle, you're like, now I know what the inside of a turtle looks like. Watch Manhattan, you're like, I don't want to know anything about this man. Ooh. He seems like the worst. So that's my hot take.
There it is, everyone. Right. Annie has spoken.
But Joe and I agree on this. So I don't want to feature him.
Yeah, I mean, you got to... The gross part of Manhattan is like bolded, italics, triple exclamation points at the end of it. Yes, I agree.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Please,
like, I feel like with gory movies, like I don't have like a problem with it. I think we all know what we're getting into when we're getting into horror.
Yeah, and I don't know if we really watch... I don't know if I set out to go like, I want to see the most like fucked up shit tonight when I watch this movie, you know?
I want to smoke a ton of weed and pass out. All right.
Well, smoking happens before, by the way.
All right. That's
how you're supposed to do it.
Yeah. What do you want people to walk away with after visiting Bleeding Skull? Like what's your hope when they go visit your website?
A sense of respect for these movies.
Okay.
For sure.
Yeah.
Like understanding.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
Oh, and I think I always would like I guess when people read it, I always want them to feel the way I feel, which is come away from it with a smile and something to watch and maybe inspiration to find more of these movies.
Wow. What three Bleeding Skull releases are your favorite and why should people watch them? And if we have six in total, three each, that's fine.
Thank you for laying the groundwork. Yeah, it's good to know. Go ahead, Annie.
Well, I'll do one. You know, I love Limbo.
What's Limbo about?
It's Tina Krause. Tina Krause was an actress and a filmmaker, but she's most known for doing the Wave movies. Wave being the DIY adult film sort of. Adult entertainment, I should say, where people would go in with a script or an idea and then contract them to make these movies. And they're usually really crazy. They always involve quicksand for some reason and a lot of outfit changes. Tina was known for that, but she made her own film that is really just a testament to her kind of strength. And she's a real spitfire. She is hilarious, and she did this all on her own on, you know, found a crew, found abandoned warehouse spaces. And it's essentially a movie about a woman going through hell, visually and emotionally. And the movie is fantastic. It's experimental, feels like a Nine Inch Nails video meets like a maybe a budget David Fincher, David Lynch.
Would we ever see you guys sitting like in the theater watching like Wedding Crashers or Batman or anything like
that? Oh, totally.
Okay. Yeah, we actually, the last movie we went to see in the theater was the Batman.
What'd you think?
So nice. Oh, I mean, I'm a huge fan of the comics. You know, I'm like comics next to like movies are my huge thing in my life. So my entire life. So I really enjoyed it. I liked it a lot. It made me happy. Yeah. I like that it focused on Batman and not Bruce Wayne so much. And I liked how it felt kind of like a horror movie almost. It's very dark and it looked beautiful. Like the photography was really beautiful. And I liked the world that it was in. So yeah, a good time.
I haven't seen it yet, but I very much want to.
So yeah, it is. It is really good. And surprisingly, for 3 hours, it did hold my attention. Like at no point was I bored. All right. Give us a few more from Bleeding Skull.
Okay. One of the ones that I really am happy with and proud of is Treasure of the Ninja, which was a film made by William Lee. And he, for the last 30 years, has been making DIY action movies on his own dime while also having a day job and just without really not a whole lot of, you know, feedback or like accolades. And in the 80s in particular, he made a whole string of these incredible martial arts epics that were shot on Super 8, total DIY. And no one had really ever seen them. They had a very small VHS release at one time. But it was like this treasure trove of stuff. So when we reached out to him and asked him if he'd be maybe interested in restoring the movies and putting them out, it was incredible because he's like, here's a list of everything. And it was like three full-length movies and like a dozen shorts and just all this stuff that had never been seen by the public. So that one in particular was really special, not only because of the movies, but because of how happy William Lee was to actually get it out there finally. And I think that's one of the things that's really unique about the AGFA and Bleeding Skull releases and all the AGFA releases, is because they are usually tend to be very obscure and very and like new discoveries for people, but they're so obscure that the filmmakers never really received any kind of like celebration. So when it finally happens, it's amazing. It's such a cool part of the whole process. So that one was really great. And we did a really great commentary with William Lee, Annie and I. That was a lot of fun. He's the best. So yeah.
Excellent.
That's awesome. All right. So listen, we got a guy in the background. Just bring him up and see if he, this is the guy that set up the interview with you guys. We always let him ask a question.
Hey.
Go ahead and ask him whatever you want.
What's up? Great to see you.
Go ahead.
I'm just kind of going to like backpedal on the last question. What's the third pick here? What would be your third pick for a Bleeding Skull physical release, and why should people seek it out?
Go ahead.
I can tell you what I'm most proud of our release. That would be Jungle Trap.
Okay.
Jungle Trap?
Yeah, great.
Yeah. that was a previously unfinished movie with Renee Harmon, Exploitation Goddess, and James Bryan, Exploitation Directing God. They had been collaborating for many years together. They had one unfinished project, which was Jungle Trap. And we had a Kickstarter. We, you know, raised money to finish it with him. Joe and I scored it. It was just an amazing project. But I also think the movie's really good. It's super low budget and fun. So much inventiveness. You know, the special effects that were just from classic Hollywood. It's a really ambitious movie, and I felt really good to have contributed to their legacy. And it's the final movie they did together. Renee passed away, so that's not going to happen again. So I'm really proud of that movie, just because we put something out there that that I think deserved to be seen and preserved, which is, you know, a rare occasion that someone like us gets to do.
Nice.
It's amazing.
All right, thank you, Jake.
Put him back in the
All right, listen, we're gonna end this interview because it took 3 months to set this up. You guys seem incredibly busy. I hesitate to ask the final question, but I feel like I need to. People want to get in touch with you, connect with you. Is there a way that they can, or you can say no? There's not.
Oh, yeah, of course. We love it when people contact us. So yeah, there's you can go to the site bleedingskull.com and go to the contact form and contact us there via email. We're also very active on social media, on Instagram and Twitter. So you can contact us through there. And AGFA as well, is that goes the same for AGFA. And I always want to say, if you contact AGFA, AGFA is open 24/7 for donations because it is a nonprofit, and you know, we always appreciate that. So, make sure that we have to say that because it's the AGFA is the only nonprofit genre film archive and distributor in the world. So, yeah.
Wow, amazing,
fantastic.
Joe, Annie, what a joy. You guys were really the greatest. It was worth the 3-month wait. In my mind, I'm like, man, these guys are high maintenance. But they're just busy.
No, they're just high.
Well, everyone, check out Bleeding Skull and
check out Bleeding Skull.
And Annie and Joe, hopefully our paths will cross one day in the near future.
For sure.
Thanks so much.
All right, guys. Thank you guys so much.
Thank you.
Okay.